are our second day on the best practice showcase celebrating technology innovation from Hispanic sources in higher education. My name is Karen Pineda, and I will be in charge of introducing the speaker for this breakout session. This session is being recorded. The presenters will let you know whether you will be able to address your question at any time during the presentation or after the presentation has finished. This presentation will be delivered in English. Simultaneous translation is available in Channel 4. Thank you. We will appreciate that you change your mobile to vibration or silent mode in order to have your full attention to this section. Finally, we will distribute the evaluation form. Please make sure to complete it before the session is over and hand it before you leave this session. Now, we are ready to start. The presenters for this session is Carlos Guevara and George Rosa from Hostos Community College. The biography information was included in the conference app's website.
So thank you for having us. We are going to be talking about and the student readiness tool that we created at Hostos Community College, and we're going to talk about the approach we took to create this tool, and we're going to give you some demo on some of the artifacts that we used for this tool. And feel free to interrupt and ask any questions at any time. Hopefully that interaction helps warm up the room a little bit. There's one additional person that is an instructional design specialist. I don't think that we could not make it, so I want to mention him in the presentation. So we'll give you some background information about the online courses that we have at Hostos. So being that we are a community college, we have not as popular to be able to create online courses, especially because of the developmental courses that we offer. So the courses are more focused on a tutorial level, on a second year type of courses, and we are working on how we can address creating an online course for developmental courses, and or sometimes science courses bring some challenges in being able to create online courses, but we have a steady increase in the number of courses, asynchronous courses that are being offered at Hostos, and we want to, and the same way as this, the number of hybrid courses that we're offering at the institution, so we want to make sure that, to create an instrument that was not a simple questionnaire that would be asking the students, do you have this, do you have that, are you comfortable reading online, doing exercises online, and then depending on what the answer is, perhaps you qualify to take an online course. So those have been some approaches. This is a graph that indicates about, we have about 33% of our full-time faculty who are certified to or have gone through the process of the online course development, and we have about 14% overall. So usually the challenge is having a lot of adjunct faculty. We have about 200 full-time faculty, about close to 400 adjunct faculty. So in the ratios that we show is so the challenges are, it's difficult to approach adjunct faculty to be certified or to even offer online courses. I think we mentioned before in a previous presentation about the difference between technology access and technology literacy. So we know that our generation, student generations, they are technology consumers. Everybody has access to the technology. Access to technology is not a problem anymore. So one of the problems we're facing is technology literacy. So we wanted to identify how we could address this problem and being able to give students hints on how you could access or use the technology for academic purposes. And so that was one of the reasons. We know that there is a growing online population for us, that's been the case. And then there is these attempts to standardize future online programs. We are working on new online programs at our institution, and there is potential cross-campus collaborations. CUNY, for those of you who are not familiar, has 44 colleges in Toronto. So CUNY has about 280,000 students in total. The 24 campuses have colleges, graduate college. We have our community colleges and all of those. Everybody does independently work in the different ways, but then we wanted to make sure how we could learn from each other, how we can collaborate, and being able to identify more collaborations as CUNY is focusing more on online learning. CUNY is calling it a digital CUNY, so how this is going to be developed in the future. So again, we have about 66 faculty certified. In this pilot population, we have about 18 faculty members participating. We have 275 students who enrolled in this course for the pilot. And from those 275 that enrolled, 179 completed. We're going to tell you how what the approach was in a minute. And this is just a snapshot of the different courses that participated. So we have a nice gamut of the different subjects for students from management, business communication, education, language arts, psychology. So we had an interesting, diverse group of students that have taken this online readiness course. So the approach we took, and just as a historical information, we were trying to find different tools to create these courses. And it's been tools that you develop a website where you have all these interactive elements, or you have quizzes, or you have that. We had there's software that you could purchase so that it becomes kind of an interactive tutorial for students, or create videos for that. And we were underestimating what our students are using. The students use BlackBerry, in our case, as the learning management system. And at the end of the day, students will have to use BlackBerry anyway. So why try different technologies, trying websites to create when we could take advantage of the same BlackBerry and making it use all the tools the most as much as we can, and being able to make the experience for the students a very welcoming, and using universal design in the sense of the levels of coverage. We know that every student has different learning styles. Not everybody learns the same way. So we wanted to present the content in different ways. We provided for those who are like to read, so we provided the content. We provided also for those that are more visual, we provided videos for them. So all the content was emphasized in different ways. And then we provided to them a test for them to assess what they have learned, and everything else that they see, they cannot. Then we use adaptive release, which allows you to scaffold the progress of the course. The student will not be able to continue unless they complete the first level. And then we were able to put some checkpoints, because you know, you can just take a look at it, you're not paying attention to it, try to take a quiz so that you can pass to the next level without paying attention to the quiz. So we, to the extent that technology allows, we try to create kind of those checkpoints. We use, as I mentioned, the Blackboard tools a lot. Testing tools, we created test pools so that the students would not get the same question the same time, so they would just go there and, okay, I know this is true, false, and then the next time, if I failed it this time, the next time I already know the answer. So we have test pools, we do randomization of the questions, randomization of the answers. So in a sense, the students will not get the same answer, the same question, whenever they put it the second time. This allows for students to pay more attention to the content. And so George is going to tell you in more detail how we developed the course and how is that we done.
Yeah, as we were developing this course, again, this course, you know, resides in Blackboard. One thing I was starting to realize was that it was actually becoming something bigger and better than just mere, a self-assessment of that a student can take in making a decision whether to go for online learning. It was actually, basically a course in both the whole concept, the whole idea of online learning, what you need, what online learning is about, and also getting down to the practicality of being able to navigate and manage the tools that faculty might use in the Blackboard course that they would need to use to get through it. Okay, so it serves it. A few purposes, which together makes it, bigger than the whole of just of your assessment. And it, they call this idea of bringing the horse to water, the idea that there's different resources, primarily the online learning support website as part of the Hostos website and also the CUNY website. But it was good to have a place where you could simply tell students where to go to learn about online learning, to assess themselves and whether they're ready for online learning, whether they feel they can handle it. Okay. Faculty can tell students, I can tell students, check out this website, check out that website. You don't know whether, you don't know if they're actually going to check it out. Here, you basically, turn them into a captive audience as far as exploring the options of online learning and Blackboard, et cetera. And then it serves a purpose of being where students can basically show their professors that they received a stamp of approval, although it isn't formal. But from EdTech, and also from the ETLC. The ETLC is the Educational Technology Leadership Council, which is basically the faculty computer and technology committee on campus that serves an advisory purpose and also establishes policy. Some of it goes through governance in the Senate. So being that they were involved in establishing again the certifications that. For hybrid and asynchronous instruction, it has developed a level of respect among faculty and administration. administration at Hostos. And so, you know, for students to go through a course that has been, you know, developed and reviewed, you know, by EdTech and EPLC, I think it gives faculty confidence that the students are prepared for the course. Okay. And another thing it takes covers topics that we often, in terms of success in an online course, faculty or administrators may not come to mind as far as what's required for success. This is, you know, we've all learned this. You know, my role in EdTech, all of our roles there. You know. Going to conferences from experience. I've developed and taught a hybrid course myself for several years. And the students coming looking for support, hearing from faculty, what type of knowledge students require to be successful in an online course. It can be kind of surprising. Students may know the content of the course, but if they're confused about where to get support as far as the technical aspects of the course, and it's not made clear to them where, you know, the best places to go for that support, and they get frustrated. You know, I've seen students, basically give up on courses because of technical aspects that if they had known, where to go, they probably wouldn't have been such a barrier. So these are the topics that are covered in the Blackboard course. There's online, probably the basic topic of online learning, what type of courses are hybrid or asynchronous. Blackboard, the introduction to Blackboard, which is great because the course is in Blackboard. So they're learning how to navigate through Blackboard, hands-on, as they're learning, the different tools of Blackboard. Where to go for support, again, like I said, that's something that people don't think about as far as a requirement for student success, that students be clear, where to go for the support for the different levels of, the different levels of skills that are required to succeed in an online course, and the different problems that, levels of problems that you have. Okay? Tech literacy, be aware of, topics such as, networks, for the different work cache with the different tools that are in our course, and the different digital web-based learning tools that both in Blackboard and outside of Blackboard. Okay. So developing different learning styles, there's aspects of it that are text heavy, but there's also audio and video. They're assessing themselves whether they're prepared to succeed in an online course, or whether they even want to take an online course or interested in online learning. And they're learning about their own possible abilities in getting to an online course, being in an online course. Okay, so they're hopefully gaining comfort in that environment while they're exploring. Okay, we looked at developing this, read the literature, looked at and explored courses and assessments at other colleges and organizations. And often I found with some courses,
it was, or what they called an assessment test, was basically more like a survey that was more a little bit an exercise in self-aggrandizement.